Doctor Who, Logopolis, written and read by Christopher H. Bidmead. Chapter 1. Events cast shadows before them, but the huger shadows creep over us unseen. When some great circumstance hovering somewhere in the future is a catastrophe of incalculable consequence, you may not see the signs in the small happenings that go before. The Doctor did, however, vaguely. While the Doctor paced back and forth in the TARDIS cloister room trying to make some sense of the tangle of troublesome thoughts that had followed him from Traken, in a completely different sector of the universe, in a place called Earth, one such small foreshadowing was already beginning to unfold. It was a simple thing. A policeman leaned his bicycle against a police box, took a key from the breast pocket of his uniform jacket, and unlocked the little telephone door to make a phone call. Police Constable Donald Seagrave was in a jovial mood. The sun was shining, the bicycle was performing perfectly since its overhaul last Saturday afternoon, and now that the main water flooding in Burney Street was repaired, he was on his way home for tea, if that was all right with the super. It seemed to be a bad line. Seagrave could hear his superintendent at the far end saying,
"Speak up. Who's that?"
But there was this whirring noise, and then a sort of chuffing and groaning. The baffled constable looked into the telephone and then banged it on his helmet to try to improve the connection. If his attention hadn't been so engaged with the receiver, he might have noticed a distinct wobble coming over the police box. Its blue surface shimmered momentarily and grew bluer. The whirring sound stopped, but then so did the voice at the other end of the line as it went dead. The constable looked ruefully at the telephone. Now he would have to cycle all the way back to the station and get permission from the super personally, by which time the sun would doubtless be gone, and with it the prospect of a relaxing afternoon in the garden potting out the sweet peas. This speculation was the constable's last thought in the world. As he replaced the receiver, his face was suddenly slammed up against the blue door as if, but that was impossible, something inside the box had grabbed his hand. His arm disappeared up to the shoulder, his head lolled back, the eyes staring. As the throttled terminal gasp bubbled away to a whisper in his throat, from inside the box echoed the light, delicate sound of a chuckle. The TARDIS was full of surprises, but Adric wasn't ready for what he saw when he turned the corner. Suddenly, he seemed to be in the open air, in a sort of crumbling stone courtyard, with a floor unevenly flagged with stone slabs. A few small twisted trees grew up between the flagstones, and beyond them, the boy caught the crimson flash of the familiar flapping coat. At least he had found the Doctor. Adric was about to call to him when he was stopped by the solemnity with which the Doctor was pacing the pillared walk that flanked the quadrangle. His strange companion seemed deeply troubled. The Doctor must have sensed that he wasn't alone because he slowed his steps and turned. So caught up in his thoughts was he that at first he appeared not to recognize the dark-haired boy. Then Adric found himself being beckoned across the quadrangle. The Doctor wasn't pleased to be disturbed. The cloister room was his special place for deep, private thinking. "Whenever you see me in here, pacing up and down like this, be a good chap and don't interrupt, unless it's terribly urgent." "It's not, is it?" The boy shook his head. The Doctor shook his too. It was as if there was a loose thought in there, rattling among the centuries of wisdom. "Well, now you know. In fact, there's no need to come barging in here at all. If it's terribly urgent, you can always ring the cloister bell." Adric had never heard of the cloister bell. The Doctor explained it was a sort of communications device, reserved for wild catastrophes and sudden calls to man the battle stations.
Battle stations? The TARDIS doesn't have them, surely?
Not as such, the Doctor replied vaguely. Still, I sometimes wonder whether I shouldn't be running a tighter ship. He scratched at a nearby pillar. The stone was powdery, like chalk, and a rivulet of dust cascaded from the point beneath the Doctor's finger. "I'm afraid the second law of thermodynamics is taking its toll of the old thing."
The Alzerians had given Adric a badge for mathematical excellence, although his grasp of physics wasn't very good. But on the journey from his home planet, Adric had had plenty of time to learn from the Doctor. And now he knew about the Earth physicist Maxwell and his ideas on entropy. Entropy was the waste energy that builds up in systems, the rust on the wheels, the weeds in the vegetable garden, the heat that eats away at components in the computer. Entropy seemed to be much on the Doctor's mind lately. Maxwell's second law of thermodynamics consisted of two grim words. Entropy increases. The Doctor sighed. The more you put things together, the more they keep falling to bits. That's the essence of the second law of thermodynamics, and I never heard a truer word spoken. Have you seen the state of the time column lately? Wheezing like a grumpus. It will get us to Gallifrey, won't it? Adric asked anxiously. Gallifrey? The Doctor spoke the name of his own planet as if it were a new word in his vocabulary. Oh, yes, yes. Are you really set on visiting Gallifrey? Adric nodded. That is where we're going, isn't it? The Doctor sat down slowly. Luckily, there was a carved stone bench set in the wall where they were standing, but there quite easily might not have been. That was the very question I was pondering, Adric, in a general way. There's bound to be a lot of fuss about Romana, why she stayed behind in East Space, official investigations, all that sort of thing. The Time Lords won't approve. Well, as a Gallifreyan, she's broken the cardinal rule. She's become involved, and in a pretty permanent sort of way. Perhaps we should let a few oceans go under the bridge before heading back home. Adric smiled to conceal his disappointment. And see Gallifrey later. The Doctor nodded, but in no very positive way. Let me put another idea to you. The place I have in mind isn't too far off our route. Well, sort of, give or take a parsec or two. It's my home from home. He turned to Adric with a grin. Oh, you'll like it. It's that place called Earth I was telling you about. That same afternoon, outside a cottage house in a quiet, village-like street many hundreds of parsecs from where the Doctor and Adric were, but less than 50 miles away from all that remained of the unfortunate Constable Seagrave, a careworn woman was sitting behind the steering wheel of a battered sports car that was almost old enough to have been new when she was a girl. Despite the spring sunshine, she was well wrapped up against the possibility of cold. There was, as she was fond of saying, no sense in taking chances with your health. A young woman in the neat purple uniform of an air stewardess came hearing out of the house, her flight bag bumping at her side. Sorry to keep you waiting, Aunt Vanessa. Let's go. Aunt Vanessa hadn't been having much luck with the starter. Every time the engine fired, then spluttered out. Tegan was barely 20 years old, but she was used to taking charge. More choke and easy on the throttle as you turn her over. Aunt Vanessa nodded her white fur hat towards the house. While I do that, dear, I wonder if you'd mind shutting the front door. Tegan's Australian accent became even broader. Oh, rabbits! I promise I'll get organized one day. Tegan closed the front door and ran back down the path again. Sorry, first flight nerves, I guess. In obedience to her niece's imperious gesture, Aunt Vanessa abandoned the intractable ignition switch and humped her bundled-up body across to the passenger seat. Immediately Tegan pulled the starter, the old engine sprang to life. Clicking on her safety belt reminded her of the training course she'd just completed, and she went into her routine. Good evening, passengers. To ensure continued safety on this flight, it is necessary to draw your attention to the oxygen apparatus situated above each seating position. Wary of drafts, Aunt Vanessa hunched further into her fur collar as the car pulled away from the curb. Tegan changed smoothly up into third. This is brought into operation by gently pulling the orange tag and placing the mouthpiece over the nose and mouth. Disposable paper bags, together with our flight magazine, may be found in the recess in the seat immediately in front of you. And she drove off down the street. Although she didn't know it then, Tegan's route was destined to take her past the mysterious police box and onto a journey very different from the passenger flight her training had prepared her for. A journey she would never forget for the rest of her life. Adric and the Doctor were walking quickly back through the maze of corridors to the TARDIS console room. It still puzzled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.